everyone, and welcome. Today, our show is about faith. We've invited several leaders of local churches to discuss this matter. We have Lisa Rubin. She's from the Unitarian Universal Church, First Parish, and you are the Director of Religious Education. We have Chris Wendell, who is the Rector at St. Paul's Episcopal Church. And we have John Castricum, who is the pastor at First Church of Christ Congregational. Welcome. I guess, suppose one of my first questions is sort of to try to figure out what the differences and similarities between you all are, because I think that is a matter of confusion for some people. So perhaps, John, you could briefly just tell us what is the First Church of Christ Congregational Church all about in a few lines? I know that might be hard, but please try.
Well, we are a church within the denomination of the United Church of Christ. The congregational tradition goes way back to the Puritans and Pilgrims. We're part of what we call the Reformed tradition of Protestant faith. We believe in the Trinity, and we believe in Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, and the Bible as our guide in life and faith. But there's tremendous diversity among different churches and people within the churches about what that all means. And we live together in dialogue and try to talk to one another and try to help and support one another in our faith journey.
Well, we'll talk a little bit more about the different sort of, I suppose, moral stands that you take and how you differentiate a little bit more from other churches. But Chris, please let us know a little bit about what St. Paul's is all about.
Well, St. Paul's is a kind of small to medium-sized congregation here in Bedford, and we're in the Episcopal tradition. If you were to line up all of the Protestant communities, from Congregationalists, Baptists, Presbyterian, the Episcopalians are probably on the end that's closer to Catholicism or to the Orthodox tradition, not because we believe in the Roman hierarchy, but because we have a deep love of the sacraments. So our community celebration every Sunday is the Holy Communion, the bread and the wine, which we bless as a community together and then share. And basically, if you look at what we're about as a church, you know, that's kind of a nice symbol for what we're about as a church, mm-hmm. an intergenerational community coming together, offering prayers and support to each other, and then sharing a meal and feeding each other. Okay. The feeding that we do at the altar is kind of a reflection of the spiritual feeding that we do for each other.
Interesting. So you're sort of liberal Catholics.
Yeah.
But do you believe that...
I wouldn't say we're all liberal, though, but we're more progressive Catholics.
You're a progressive church. And Lisa, you are known as a very progressive church in town. Perhaps you could just briefly define what the universal faith is.
Unitarian Universalist faith.
Yes.
Well, we actually started with the congregational.
You all started
we were all
with the
congregational. And our Unitarian Universalism is a fluid religion. It keeps growing and changing and developing. It is a religion that helps people do their search, and its First Parish in Bedford celebrates radical hospitality, welcoming all diversities, and helping people search for what's true for themselves.
So there's no particular belief in one God. It's sort of whatever you believe in is fine with the Unitarians?
What we have are seven principles that we affirm and promote together.
Oh, I see, okay. I mean, I think that's one of the questions I do want to ask, and it's certainly a relevant question in this day and age, is about diversity. And I think a lot of younger people don't feel that they would be accepted in the church because they are gay, or they have gay friends, or they have alternative lifestyles, or something doesn't quite match up with the strict scriptures. How would you respond to that? Do you accept gay people in your church? Do you accept non-believers?
Absolutely. I think the United Church of Christ has had a program for many, many years called the Open and Affirming Program, where churches are given the choice to declare themselves to be an open and affirming congregation. First Church Congregational did this many years ago, and ever since then we have a statement of radical inclusivity. No matter who you are or where you are in your faith journey, you're welcome here. And that really goes to no matter who you are, you're just welcome and accepted to join us in that journey.
Now, that's the case with all of you, right? You're very accepting of different... Now, so do you modernize your religion as you go along? What if the scripture says bad, and you're like, not bad? So how does that
Wait
work?
Wait a minute. Scripture doesn't speak with one consistent voice? I'm so confused.
Me too.
So, yeah, this
is... The Bible. I guess I should say the Bible. I mean, I think a lot of people say, okay, well, you know, how do you interpret the Bible?
Good question.
Is that the pivotal question?
Well, it's a very important question. Mm-hmm. And I know in our tradition, we look at three sources of authority to understand what it is that God is hoping for from us as people of faith. And those sources are scripture, reason, and tradition. And we think of them as like a three-legged stool on which our faith rests. Scripture alone is not enough for our tradition. We need to bring into scripture reasoned reflection based on all sources of human knowledge and inquiry, including science and the arts and studies of history,
so
studies of language.
Do you believe in evolution?
Absolutely.
Okay.
My wife is an engineer.
Yeah.
I'd be in deep trouble if I didn't
believe
in evolution.
I see. Now, are there factions within your denomination that disagree with you and say, no, this is wrong? I mean, is there a lot of argument now within your churches about what is acceptable and what is not in terms of doctrine?
Not much left in ours. We, I'd say in the 90s and in the early 2000s, there was a little bit of controversy around whether the Episcopal Church was going to be a place for all people. And the people who don't believe that pretty much are not in the Episcopal Church anymore.
I see.
And so the people who are here and the congregations that are thriving and growing welcome everyone. And
your boss is a lady.
No, our boss is a guy, but we have
the
several.
Head bishop was a lady.
We have two bishops. One is a man, Tom, and one is a woman, Gail.
Okay.
And so you know, we believe that God welcomes everybody, that Jesus welcomed everybody, and so who are we as followers of Jesus not to welcome everybody with open arms?
And Lisa, the Unitarians are about the same. Do you believe in heaven or hell?
It depends on who you talk to.
Oh, is that right?
Everyone has it.
So it's a convenience.
You know, Unitarian Universalism gives people the place to explore what it means for them. What does heaven mean to you?
I see.
What does it mean? And what does hell mean to you? And, you know, you get two Unitarian Universalists in the same room, you're going to have two different opinions.
You know, I have been doing sort of a journey through spirituality and trying to understand God from different perspectives. And I was trying to understand what the relevancy is of churches. Wouldn't it be better or not? I don't know. I'm just wondering, is it sort of separatist to say, okay, you have to believe in this in order to be a member of our church, and then we're going to do common good? Wouldn't it be better to sort of coalesce things and say, okay, we're all in this together. Have you thought about such issues? Does the church think about such issues? Oh, are we too divisive? Are we too singular? Are we too separate? Should we spread our net? Does that come up in conversation, John?
Not too much, because as a denomination and as a church, we are incredibly diverse. As I said, we have a belief in Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior and the Bible as our rule and guide and faith. But there is a lot of room in the middle of that to figure out what that means for each and every person. So, yes, I think it's important for us to define ourselves as a Christian community, as worshiping God through Jesus Christ, as understanding Jesus as the great manifestation of God, God's love, God's will for us. That's critical at our core, but there are so many ways of understanding that. And so many people have different opinions, and we listen to each other. I listen to my congregation because they have a lot to say about that. But we're really doctrinally, we're not really hard.
Hardcore, yes. Yeah,
hard, about that.
About
I think a lot of people often lump our churches with maybe more evangelical churches, which have very strong doctrinal beliefs, and you're either
absolutely
in or you're out.
Absolutely.
We're really not in that same camp. I think that's pretty true for all of us.
Yeah.
We look at the world religions. We look at the wisdom from world religions and from science and from earth-centered spirituality. We have a, I think we cast a wider net around where you look for what is true for you and what speaks to you, and we celebrate the mystery and the wonder of the world and the beauty in the ordinary. Mm-hmm. And so God is something that either people may not even use the word God or interpret it as it fits for them.
Mm-hmm. So I'm really glad you asked this question, because I actually think it's a really important question. What is the relevance of being in a church. Being in a church community? You know, there's so many dimensions to that question, but I want to start by saying I think that when I got into ordained ministry, I didn't actually expect that I would serve a parish as a rector. I kind of thought maybe I'd study theology and write, you know, books and that kind of thing. And as soon as I got into my first parish, I realized I had missed it, that really parish life does something incredibly special that in American society today, there are fewer and fewer places to get. And that has to do with being an intergenerational community of support. Mm-hmm. I can't tell you what a wonderful feeling it is, and I'm sure this would be true for all of us, to go to one of our services or to go to our coffee hour or one of our fellowship events or a Bible study or some kind of Christian formation, and to see people across the different decades of the human life experience loving each other, caring about each other's challenges and problems, mm-hmm. because no one's life is perfect, mm-hmm. and we all need support. And parishes provide, when they're doing what they're supposed to be doing, parishes provide that kind of care and compassion and support. When things are good, we celebrate together, and when things are hard, we mourn together, and we work through our challenges together. They're not conflict-free, but they're really a place where you can get something that I think is rarer and rarer in American life, and that's intergenerational community. And I just want to add to this question about kind of beliefs and, you know, what do you have to believe to be there? In our tradition, believing and belonging are not sequential. So you don't have to believe before you belong. We believe that God works with all human beings in their lives and in their journeys and in their hearts. Mm-hmm. And some people belong before they believe. Some people believe before they belong. Mm-hmm. And some people don't really know where they are. And I know at least in the Episcopal tradition at St. Paul's, we're very welcoming of all those places of being. Mm-hmm. We are a Christian community. We do profess a belief in Jesus as both fully human and fully divine, but just because the community holds that as our collective belief doesn't mean necessarily that every single person in the community is all the way there on every feature of our creeds.
Well, I think one of the issues that certainly the younger generation that I hear and read about is this whole concept of heaven and hell. I think people get very hung up on this. And sort of the assumption is, well, I can't be good all the time, so I guess I'm damned, so I might as well just give up the whole darn thing. I do believe that that is really a very common thought pattern. How would you address that?
Well, I think when you're worried about getting into heaven or hell, you're almost down the wrong road or you've heard the wrong message.
Oh, interesting. Okay.
I think following a religion's order to get into heaven, while it might be central to some churches, I think you have to find your heaven here. You have to find what Jesus called the kingdom of God here on earth to make it real, to do that. If you're thinking about what's going to happen to you after you die, well, I don't know what kind of life that really is, you know?
I think a number of people believe in God as an insurance policy.
That's too bad.
And so, of course, that factors in. I mean, I know that a lot of people go to church because the community aspect is really the hugest part. And I can see how much good that does in our community. And I'm really in awe of everything that all of you do for us and for the people around you. It's really incredible.
I think we might all agree that God is just not out there to punish people for doing bad things. I mean, for me personally, in Jesus, God is a God of love and mercy and compassion and forgiveness that is not out to judge us. And I mean, there's some people who think that everything bad that happens to them, God is somehow punishing them. And that's so far from the truth.
I think that Unitarian Universalism, because we're not saying that you have to have a belief in God, that we're helping you to find what your truth is and to find your spiritual core mm-hmm. for yourself. I think that's more why people come in the door of Unitarian Universalist parishes and congregations. And I think we all notice that during a time of crisis in our, you know, in our country is when new people come in. Mm. When during a time of personal crisis,
so they're searching for comfort.
They're searching for
meaning,
a community to be a part of, to find the answer or comfort.
So, in my way of thinking about it, you know, I think that at the center of the universe is God, and we say and often sing that God is love. And, you know, my take on this is that I've been doing a lot of funerals lately. We've had more than our average number of deaths of late. You know, it kind of comes and goes in spurts. So I've been preaching at a lot of funerals. And one of the things I often say at a funeral is that here's what I think about life and God and death and heaven. You know, all of us are on a journey to a deeper and deeper life of compassion and generosity. Generally, we make that journey by going two steps forward and one step back. If we worry all the time about the judgment that we might incur by taking a step back, we're never going to take any steps forward. And I think when we get to the end of our life, God kind of picks us up, sees how far we've gone, and then says, well, you gave it a good shot. Mm-hmm. And then we spend the rest of our eternity in communion and in deep closeness with the divine, with that spirit of love and compassion that's at the center of the universe. Mm-hmm. So I don't know how that plays into discussions of heaven and hell, but that's mm-hmm. what I believe happens with our being, and that's how I think God thinks about us.
Well, I really appreciate this sort of much more expanded view. I think people have a very limited view of what the different religions represent, mm-hmm. and, you know, because of the way perhaps we were raised, mm-hmm. and we're sort of stuck in that way, or perhaps because the extremists seem to have a louder voice than the moderates, so that's who people are listening to. So we can see what works with religion. Mm-hmm. It's faith, it's community. Lisa, I'm going to start with you. What do you think is not working with your church? And I'm going to ask all of you this. And I realize this is a difficult question to answer, but where do you think work needs to be done, given the changing times, the moral, different moral values? And you can say, you know, we're perfect.
Yeah, I'd like to say we're perfect. I think we're doing a good job. I think the place where we lose people for the time being is during young adulthood. Because during childhood and youth years, we have a lot of programming, we're meeting their needs regularly. And when they leave and go off on their own for a while, they know they have their faith community back home, but they don't always looking for that same faith community where they live. And so that is the place where young people, young adults, aren't necessarily mm-hmm. coming back to a congregation, to a faith congregation. Mm-hmm. And then what seems to happen is when they have children of their own and they want their children to have a community of faith. Also, Unitarian Universalism is a place where couples of different faiths, of mixed faiths, can come together and find a safe community where their own background, their own faith can be celebrated, and they can build something new which has the values that brought their parents together and the values that people cherish. And we're value-based more.
I see. Mm-hmm.
So for us, I think there's a big shift happening in American Christianity from the institutional to the relational, and that's great because
if I don't know what you mean by
I'm
that.
I'm going to explain it. Here we go. So in the 50s and 60s, people really connected with Christianity in America through being part of an organization that did good things, and that's not unimportant, but. What we're seeing is that in all forms of American life, people are more interested in relationship and authenticity. And that's great for Christians because the Trinity, our central image of what God is not singular, it's relational. It's three beings in perfect relationship with each other. And so our church, where we're headed, where St. Paul's and the Episcopal tradition, and I think most of Western Christianity is headed, is into really into the authentic and relational parts of our members' lives. You know, I've been here 2 years, and I think that one of the most important things that our church can do for its community is to really let people engage the deep spiritual questions that are in their hearts, you know.
Like, what if you're wrong?
Well, I actually think it goes.
No,
I think it goes.
I think a lot of people ask that.
Well, that's an important question, but
I'll ask you that afterwards.
But that's not really what I was getting at. Like, I just think when you ask people what their biggest spiritual dilemmas are, they're things that really matter in their lives. Like, should I stay in this marriage? You know, what should I be doing for my kids? Why is there so much poverty in the world? Why is there so much violence
everywhere? How can I help?
And what is it, what in my heart and in my soul and in my being and with my resources can I do to respond to that in a way that helps to build this community of compassion and love? That's where I think we're headed. And I think all churches can do more focusing on these kind of real questions that have big consequences for
individuals
and for communities. Right. And less about, you know, is this right or wrong? Is this point of doctrine helpful, you know, good or not good? And more like, where is God actually in my life and trying to help me find greater resources of generosity and, and hope?
John, how do you put
Well, I could piggyback on what Chris is saying because I think in the 50s and 60s, we understood the church as somewhat of another civic institution, kind of a place where people get their moral compass and guide, a place where people can network and connect, which is all, again, very good to do. But I think what we lost is the spiritual connection that is so important in the church. And so before I came, our church went through a three-year process of discernment and really had the sense that they want to go into the direction of getting more into spiritual practices, learning more about prayer, doing Bible reading in a transformative way, and worshiping in an alive, relevant way so that the Spirit of God can really come and they can experience that transformation that's available. But you can't do that unless you connect with God. I mean, you can talk about God all you want, but experiencing God in your personal life, alive and a powerful presence, doing something within you and in your community and in your world, well, that's a totally different matter.
Well, that's the question, one of the, I think, a pivotal question for people like me who are non-believers. I have seriously questioned the existence of God. Is the interpretation of what is God to you? What is God to anyone? What is faith for you? And why does it have to be in a religious situation? What about the Rotarians? What about, and I'm not saying it's bad or good. I can see how much the churches have done, and it amazes me, and I have great respect for that. I think myself and a lot of other people just don't understand why God.
I've seen God's presence transform people's life in powerful ways. Healing relationships, giving people hope, pulling people out of pits of despair and depression, bring them into a whole sense of wholeness, bringing joy back into their lives, taking lives that are scattered and a mess and searching. And you can certainly get a lot out of community organizations. That's certainly true. There's no doubt about it. You can find all sorts of spiritualities around, but when you come to a church and experience the presence of God within a community, it can really do something for you. And quite frankly, everybody has needs. They have things they're searching for. They have problems that seem really hard to impossible to solve. And the presence of God working within them and through the community and through the church makes a difference. And I've seen that.
Thank you. That is a powerful answer.
So sometimes it's not God that people are looking for because of where they are. Sometimes it's relevance. It's their personal relevance in life and what is relevant to me. And at First Parish in Bedford, we offer many opportunities, so many diverse opportunities for people to address what is relevant in their life in a faith community. So they're not being questioned about what God is to them, but they're feeling a sense of relevance, a sense of spirituality. We reach outside of our building. We connect. I know that we all do social action. We're all very socially active.
And by the way, I just want to say that we did call all of the religious organizations in town, not the Buddhist temple, because we couldn't quite reach them. And you three are really the only ones who have responded. Just to be fair, we did try to get a lot of different points of view.
I can't prove that God exists to you, but I can tell you why.
That would be amazing, though.
I can tell you why I believe that God does.
What a miracle now.
Yeah, right. You know, I'll just speak personally, right? So
please.
For me, God is the place where I can be the most vulnerable of all. It's a place, you know, when I pray, when I talk to God, for me, it's a place that's just so free and open. In a way that is often so hard to do in our lives and in our communities, even with the people that we love the most. There's something so affirming about being known by God, about being known by the center of love and compassion and generosity in the universe, being known personally, being known that you're connected to that, and that not just you are connected to it, but in fact, every single person on this earth is connected to it. And the church, or churches, or communities of faith, really are the most diverse, broadest gathering places of human beings. And so for me, my belief in God is really about knowing that in my most true and honest and authentic moments, even when they're pretty vulnerable, I'm connected to that spirit of forgiveness and love and grace. And so for me, that's why I believe in God. I'm not sure that really answers your question, but that's what it does for me.
One of the wonderful things about the churches is that it really is probably the most underlying message, wouldn't you say, is of faith is love and care for one each other.
Mm-hmm. And an unconditional love. An unconditional love that doesn't really mind who you are, what you've done in your life.
Wow,
you're just plain love.
And that is something that because we're all welcoming and affirming. And,
absolutely.
That's something that our three congregations have in common. So people in this area of needing a faith community, Protestant, whether you're Episcopalian.
And we're doing the sacraments.
Right, yeah. Or you're Unitarian Universalist.
Right.
And we're all celebrating everyone's differences, I think, and our... In Unitarian Universalism, we say the inherent dignity and worth of all people. I mean, that affirming and promoting that is our first principle.
And you know, that phrase is actually in our baptismal service in the Episcopal Church. We promise when you're baptized that we'll affirm the inherent dignity and worth of every human being. Mm-hmm. Not exactly the same, but very close.
You all should just get together and just go all under one roof and you know, same male.
We have some
We do have differences.
Yeah, I can see
definitely.
That. Well, thank you so much. I hope we get together again and talk a little bit more.
More
I would
subjects.
Love to talk about faith and all.
We'll do an hour next time.
That's right.
You know? But thank you again, John, Chris, and Lisa. Thank you so much for coming on Bedford TV and talking to us about religion.
Thank you.
You're welcome.